Hocam.
Hocam sesiniz gelmiyor. Arkadaşlar sorry, sesim gelmemiş. Uyarı için teşekkürler. Birkaç şey tekrar edeceğim tabii ki hiçbiriniz duymadığınız için. Okay guys, this is the second part of the course. And in the second part of the course, we'll be delving into new stuff. Geliyor değil mi şu anda sesin?
Şu an geliyor.
Evet hocam.
Geliyor hocam.
Uyarı için teşekkürler. And in the second part of the course, actually, up to now, in the 4 hours we have covered, we were trying to remember the basic digital design concepts because what we are going to cover is related to these, to those concepts. And from this part, we'll be learning about microprocessors. And with this slide, I'll try to introduce you the microprocessor we use. Guys, we are using an ARM microprocessor. Actually, ARM, which stands for Advanced RISC Machine. RISC is also an abbreviation. Forget what it is. ARM is a British company. And they have been producing microprocessors for years now. In the 80s, when this company was first founded, they've come up with very nice designs. And today, actually, they are not producing the cards. They are designing the cards. You may have realized that the card that we use in this lecture is a card of Texas Instruments. Texas Instruments is a company from the United States. However, ARM is a British company because ARM designed the card, have the patent for it, and Texas Instruments and many chip producing companies all around the world produces their designs. So this is like the brain team of cards guys, and they are actually designing the best cards in the world. Okay, so this is the family of cards ARM currently produces, the classic ARM processors, not currently being used anymore, not much. The embedded ones, which are called Cortex-M and Cortex-R, and the application cards, Cortex-A. So these M cards, Cortex-M cards, are smaller with lower capability but lower power demand, for example. And these cards are more for higher usage, like robotics or more complicated systems. We are using this one. So all these names you see are actually architectural designs. These guys are computer architectures, computer architects. Okay. So you know what an ARM is at this point. The Cortex-M4 processor we use is where it was designed for digital signal processing purposes. That's why most of the electrical and electronics engineering departments all around the world uses this card currently. I mean, University of Texas uses this card. Middle East Technical University in Otto uses this card, and we are using this card as well. So as an electrical and electronics engineer who does the signal processing of the world, because nobody else can do it but us, Cortex-M4 was specifically designed for this purpose, signal processing capabilities. Computing capability of the device is selected such. Okay. So, well, these cards, different cards exist because in the world, when you design a computer system or a controller system or an embedded system, you always have to make a trade-off between power, computational complexity, the size. So that's why ARM produces very different family of cards. And actually, Cortex-M cards are low power, low cost. It's very important because when you consider a device, I mean, you produce a device and you sell them like millions. So if you can keep the cost low, that would be fantastic. Or the power. I mean, nobody wants a device, a mobile device, which will eventually get its battery depleted very fast, right? So low power, low cost, and ease of use. These are simple devices. So it is perfect for an introductory level. But it is not very simple, guys. I'm compared to the PIC devices. Maybe you have heard of the PIC devices. PIC devices were previously used. I mean, there are some departments still using PIC devices, but architecturally, PIC devices are very simple. But in Cortex-M4, we also have the complex architectural designs that we must learn in a microprocessor course. That's why we select this one. That's why all the, I mean, proper universities of the world select this one. Okay. So we should understand embedded systems, because what we are going to learn in this course will be a part of the embedded systems. Why we are learning microprocessors, one might ask. Everybody asks me this question. We are learning assembly language. Nobody uses assembly language. I know, but somebody has to learn. So, I mean, you learn how to read the syllables in first grade when you were a seven-year-old kid, but you never read syllables in your life. That's how you learn to read, guys. So in order to be a good embedded programmer, embedded systems engineer, a C programmer, first you should understand the basics of hardware and software, because assembly language is the language between the hardware and software. So using this microprocessor knowledge, we are going to be implementing embedded systems. An embedded system is a computer system who has a dedicated function for a mechanical or electrical system, whatever it is. And usually it's real time. So for example, in your washing machine, you have an embedded system. You program it and accordingly, it just pumps the water, just turns the wheel, whatever. I always give the same example because I love the fact that there's an embedded system in a washing machine. So it is embedded as a part of its complete device, often including hardware or mechanical parts. Why we call it embedded? Because a microcontroller or a microprocessor is embedded, gömülü, inside the washing machine itself. when I look at the washing machine, I can see that it can program itself. It can do a programming. It can do something it was programmed for. And I immediately think of this. Oh, there's an embedded microprocessor inside it. That's why they are called embedded. There's an embedded microprocessor inside it. Embedded systems control many devices, guys. And all the microprocessors are manufactured as components of embedded systems, nearly all, 98%. That's the relation with us, microprocessors and embedded systems, guys. That's why we have another course, a technical course in the second semester, which is related to this course. You first learn microprocessors, and then you learn embedded systems. Previous week, I tried to create a course on board. You remember? You learn circuits and systems, then you learn analog circuits, then you learn digital circuits, flip-flops, then you learn logic design, then you learn microprocessors, this course. Embedded systems, computer architecture. When somebody asks you, do you know how computers work? That's how you can answer it, guys. Okay, so embedded systems are everywhere. I mean, they are ubiquitous, invisible, you cannot see them. They have a dedicated purpose. Everything has embedded systems, okay? And usually they have the similar parts, guys. They have memory, they have a processing unit, they have an interface, and they have other devices. So there's a sensor here, which is communicating with the interfaces, this microcontroller. This is a microcontroller. This is the microprocessor, be careful. Okay, so microcontroller is processor plus memory plus the interfaces, the way you speak to the outside world. Okay, this is where we are. So why ARM? There are other companies like PIC or like Intel, but ARM has won the race, guys. Actually, it's been, I mean, thought that in the world today, there are about 10 billion, not million, guys, billion, B, the second letter of the alphabet, billions of ARM processors currently working on the planet right now. So ARM had the best designs, and if you learn the ARM architecture, and if you become an embedded programmer in real life, you'll most probably will be able to use the capabilities you learned about architectures. And for example, there was an email, one of your friends emailed me this week, and she asked, there's a card that she has at home, and will it serve the purposes of this course? Well, actually, yes, that's a microprocessor, and basically it has the same components. However, we are going to delve into the specific architecture of ARM to understand the microprocessors. Although they are similar, our architecture is a bit different, and we will focus on that architecture. Since this is a practical course, you will need an ARM card in this case, guys. Just use the simulator or buy it or try to find it. You will need a specifically ARM architecture. They are the most widespread and they are the best choice. So what is the architecture? You remember this, this was a funny architecture. I mean, this is the architecture of a microprocessor, but it actually represents basically what it is. You have a clock, you have a program counter, you have some place in the memory where you write your instructions. No question? No. Then you have registers. What they are for, we'll see. And you have an arithmetic logic unit, which does the operations. And there are connections and buses. This is previous week's slide, you remember. So what is the architecture of our system? I mean, the architecture is so complex, guys. Impossible to put in a single slide. I mean, you actually, the data sheet is 1,500 pages, more than that. This is the most high level picture I can show you. Okay, this is the processor. The internal peripherals, okay, internal peripherals are actually the registers in this case, this guy. So we can read and write information. Registers, this is the registers. And this is the memory you add. This is like the hard disk, or this is the instruction memory. This is where you put your instructions, your code. So it is this one. So peripherals, registers, instructions. Sorry, this one and this one. And this is the hard disk. This is where we put our data, okay? And we also have something that this guy doesn't have, the input-output ports, so that we can talk outside. The stupidity about this example was, this primitive example could not talk to the outside world because there was no interfaces. This guy has also interfaces. So basically, this is our architecture. This shows our capabilities, guys. Okay, these are the internal peripherals, the registers. This is the instruction memory. And you also have clock, of course. So you might ask, where is the program counter? Actually, program counter is a register inside the internal peripherals. You'll learn this. And we have a specific place called memory as well, which is like the hard disk. We are going to calculate values in the registers, and we will save them to this random access memory, that hard disk. Okay, this is the basic architecture. Good. Okay, to understand how this guy works, I'll immediately start with the registers, guys. So it was the registers. So this guy has some specific registers. In these registers, I can keep information. Very good. What kind of registers do I have? Actually, this is the registers list. At the first glance, you won't be able to understand what these registers are for. I'm going to just slowly introduce them to you. Don't worry. The first thing you must learn, there are registers, there are 13 registers from R0 to R12, okay? These are scratch paper registers. Scratch paper, Turkish, müspette kağıdı. I've given you this example the previous week. When you want to calculate something, what you do is, I ask you 7 times 16. Well, if you are smart enough, you are all smart enough. You do the calculation in your heads. But if I ask something complex like 17 times 255, you'd better use pen and paper, right? You get a pen and paper, you do the calculations, and you find the result. Actually, these registers are like that müspette kağıdı. And when the microprocessor wants to calculate something, actually the arithmetic logic unit wants to calculate something, it will use these registers as the müspette kağıdı. Because the microprocessor will work like, okay, I have an addition block. In this addition block, feed me 2 values. I'm going to tell you the addition. You're going to feed the registers. Okay, get this register and get that register. And write the answer to that register. It is like the müspette kağıdı you use, the scratch paper. Okay, so these guys are where we are going to do the calculations on. Never forget this. What are these registers for? They are the scratch paper registers. Very good. Other than that, basically these registers are some cells, they're flip-flops that can keep 0 and 1s. I mean, they have no capabilities. They can only keep information. It's like a hotel room. And in front of their door, there's something written. In this room, it's written R0. When I say R0, the microprocessor will immediately go to that hotel room and get the information there. And each one of them can keep 32-bit information. So in each internal register, these registers, the guys here, we have 32 bits. We can keep 32 bits. That's why this microprocessor is 32 bits, guys, because most of the operations in the ALU are also 32 bits. Actually, that is what a 32-bit microprocessor means. Whatever. So these are hotel rooms. In their doors, on their doors, these numbers are written. And whenever I call this, I am the arithmetic logic units. Hey, go get the number in R0. I'll be able to get because they are connected to the internal peripherals. Okay, we have these. We understand these. These are the simple registers. What about the other ones? They are also little cells, guys. They are also some hotel numbers. And they are also 32 bits. So when I call SP, actually it's R13, but I'm going to call it stack pointer or link register program counter. They keep 32 bit of information, nothing else. So any information is kept there, but they are not scratch paper registers. So I'm not using those registers to write on something. They are like, if these registers were müspette kağıdı, scratch paper on my desk, these are like some important papers. They are like references. When I just want to learn something, what was it? Let me just look at that paper. Let me read the stack pointer. Okay, what was written on the stack pointer? So it is like this. There are some references. What information they carry? We don't know yet. I'm going to teach you. That's why they are called function registers. They have a special function. When I need to learn something from them, I read it. Okay, similarly, in addition to special function registers, there's something called the special registers, PSR, primask. At this point, these are no difference to you. The important thing is they are just hotel rooms. They can keep 32 bits and they have a purpose. And these guys are not like these guys because these guys were scratch papers I could write on. These are not. I read and write information to these registers. to control the microprocessor. Okay? The microprocessor keeps things. Actually, you know one of them, the program counter. The program counter was the register which was increased by the clock signal, right? As the clock signal continued, this changed. And it controlled which instruction I am at. You remember? It's the same. So there's a program counter here. It is actually connected to this guy, and it provides you which instruction is given. We're going to go into details of it. Don't worry. Just program counter, link register, we are going to learn. And I'm going to teach you how to debug them on screen. When the lab starts, your teaching assistant will teach you how to use the Kale. And actually, we are going to read these registers. What is written in the program counter? Wow. So let me get to the next instruction. Wow, it's increased. You are going to see this. Don't worry. But we are learning them theoretically now. Okay. So we have the scratch paper registers, which we can write on and just throw away, just delete. And these are the special function registers, which we use to understand what's going on in the microprocessor. They have specific purposes. What are they? I am going to teach you. Okay, so guys, general purpose registers, scratch papers, müsvedde kağıtları. General purpose registers are like the memory of a PC. In your desktop computers or your laptops, you have memory, right? What is this memory? Why is it different from the hard disk? Because when you just switch off your computer, you lose everything in the memory, right? But the things that you have in your hard disk, you keep them. So it is like this. I mean, the information in the registers are for immediate operations. It is like the memory of a PC. When you just switch it off, you lose it. You will lose everything in the registers. So that's why I call it like a scratch paper müsvedde kağıdı. ALU will process this data. It is for the ALU to make operations. Just like the memory of a desktop computer. Memory is used to make operations. When you're doing an operation on a Word document, everything is kept on memory. When you're finished, you save it, and it's dead in the memory. So it is like this. So it resembles, the function of it resembles the memory of a desktop system. So it is here, guys. I have 13 of these. But for some of you, this may sound a bit much. Why do I have this much registers? For some of you, this may sound small. I mean, I need more scratch paper. Well, apparently, after years of design, ARM has concluded that for a system of this level, a mobile Cortex-M4 processor, 13 scratch registers are enough. That's why. It's an architectural decision. And these guys are the best. And if they said so, this must be enough. So it's general purpose. Scratch paper. Okay, any questions? I'm just running a bit fast. So if you have questions, please ask. Okay, no microphone sound, so I guess everything's okay. Okay, and about special function registers, guys. I told you this was, remember, this was, sorry. So these were registers. We talked about them. And this is special function registers. Well, you know program counter. It's both readable and writable. Because if you want to change what you run in the instruction memory, you'll have to change this. Again, the link register. Well, what is its purpose? It's used to store the return location for functions. You didn't understand anything. Don't worry, we're going to understand. Just know that there is a special register here that can keep information. And in time, at some point, we'll use this link register somehow. It is a hotel room, and it can keep 32 bits of information. Someday we are going to use this. Similarly, the stack pointer. There's a data structure called stack in our system. We are going to use it. How? We don't know yet. Just know that there's a hotel room there. Good?
Hocam.
Please.
Ben pek bir şey anlamadım da. Please. Bu dediğiniz link register kısmında stack pointer. Yani how nasıl yapacağımızı şu an bilmiyoruz ya, öğreneceğiz. Hı-hı. Ama biraz örnek verebilir misiniz?
Well, your friend is, I understand. Yeah, I understand. Your friend is saying that, okay, maybe, I guess you understood this part. This is just scratch paper.
Evet.
I mean, okay, you had an idea about this. But about these ones, she's saying, I have no idea. Guys, actually, these registers are used to implement very complex data structures, which you don't know yet, okay? So at this point, I only expect you to know that this is a 32-bit register, nothing else. So when I say link register, there is something in the system, 32 bits of place where I can read and write, nothing else. So just you wonder, I understand, you just want to learn, but it has to has an order, guys. I mean, the link register is about jumping from functions. I mean, let me just give you an introduction. Most probably you won't be able to properly get all of it, but since you asked, I'm going to give you this example, but you don't have to understand this example as well. In computers, you have a main function, right? Main code. You are running the main code. You sometimes jump to functions. That's the function, I mean, just remember in C or MATLAB, you've learned functions, right? When you jump a function, you want to return to the, when you're finished within the function, you want to return to the main code. And at that point, actually returning to the main code is finding your way in the instruction memory. And you need the link register to save where to return in the instruction memory. But this is a complicated process, guys. I'm going to teach you every detail of it. So understanding its purpose, you're not ready for it right now. What I expect you to do is just know that there are some registers with these names right now. Okay, don't worry. Don't worry. I mean, microprocessors is a bit complicated course in the sense that in the first 1 or 2 weeks, it's a bit confusing, but it will unreveal itself. So it will reveal itself. Don't worry. Okay, I hope this will satisfy your question. I mean,
yes.
I'm not going to be able to explain it right at the moment. Okay, thank you anyway. Please ask. I just don't want to discourage you to ask any question. Okay, so these are some registers that you know their names right now, and they can keep 32 bits of information. So inside, there are 32 binary numbers. What they are for, we are going to learn. So guys, these are the special registers, right? And there is another special register here, this one only, PSR. I'm going to show you the internal structure of the PSR. You still won't understand what they are for, but what I'm trying to teach you at this point is, this PSR has some bits in it. So this is the PSR. Actually, for example, bits 0 to 8 is an information. Bits 10 to 15 is another information. Bit 24 is an information. And these informations have names. AND bit, Z bit, carry bit, overflow bit, whatever they are. We don't know these operations, but in time, we are going to learn how to use the microprocessor. And I will construct sentences like, when you do this operation, you remember the summation example I did. So one of your friends asked, what happens to the carry? You remember that question? Because it was like, it was lost on the board. This bit will be one. The purpose of this bit was specifically this. I'm going to teach you this. This is an example to show you, to give you an idea what they're about. The LO will sum two numbers. If there's a carry, it will make this one one, because you will need that information. Okay, so these special registers all have special purposes, and actually they have these special purposes in their bits. Don't worry, I'm going to be returning to these. I'm just introducing them to you. So in microprocessors and embedded systems, you will see things like these, like data sheets. You have the data sheet of the PSR, this program status register, PSR, this one. So you don't understand what it's for. You should immediately, this will happen to you a lot. You should immediately think that, okay, this means that I'm going to be learning a capability of the microprocessor. And once something happens in the microprocessor, some bits will change. I'm going to look at these bits. How to look at them, you are going to learn. I'm just trying to give you some conceptual perspective. Okay, so these are some registers I'll be checking when I'm doing my computations. Okay, like the carry bit. Did a carry happen? Ah, yes, a carry must have happened, kind of.
Okay. Sen soracaktım. Bu please. Network'teki frame'ler gibi değil mi?
Which network? I mean, I couldn't get exactly what you meant by network and frame.
Mesela IPv4 bir IP adresi tanımlarken içerisinde frame'ler oluyor bilgi için.
Okay. Yeah, well, actually, I mean, IP and networking, computer networking, is a good example in the sense that they both carry information. Yes, inside an internet packet, you have a field which carries the information, and it's called a frame. And within that part, you have some data. You don't know what it's for. You can use that data. And in that sense, these are some cells that carry data. You are correct in that sense. However, the internet packet is a conceptual thing. I mean, it's ones and zeros you send over a line, right? It's a theoretical subject, but these are actually real flip-flops. There's a flip-flop. There are cells there that carry this information. These are hardware. So in that sense, they are different. So I hope this is an answer to your question. Okay, so don't worry, guys. I mean, it's getting complicated, but it will unravel itself. And you'll understand it and you will like it a lot. Don't worry. So guys, actually, if you get to the details of this, they all have meanings. I'm going to return to these slides. You're going to do some operations. For example, you are going to add two numbers in the ALU. You're going to add -3 to +3. -3 plus +3 is zero, right? If the answer is zero, this will be important for you for some reasons. In that case, this zero flag will rise. It is showing that the last operation you did on the microprocessor resulted in a zero. These are important, guys, because these kind of informations we are going to use to construct logic and algorithms. How we are going to get? Just know that, keep in mind that, when I do an operation on the ALU, for example, I'm going to say, hey, ALU, sum the numbers in R0 and R1. And the ALU will assume that they are 2's complement signed numbers, always. If there is -3 here, there is +3. And I'm going to give the arithmetic logic unit an instruction. Say, sum the two numbers in R0 and R1 and write it to R2. It's going to write it to R2. And if the numbers are zero, it's going to warn me. It will give me a warning. Hey, I've written this, but also I made this flag 1 because the result is zero. Why? Because this is how we will construct some logic. Actually, operation being zero is an important, sign because it will make us life easy to construct algorithms. How? You don't know yet. Just know that this bit will be zero if the last operation of the arithmetic logic unit is zero. Simple. Guys, okay? Let me give you a perspective on it. I mean, you don't need this information, but let me just make you think so. So, imagine this is, yes. Okay, so, guys, this is a complex architecture, right? Very complex architecture. And you have this ALU here, arithmetic logic unit. And you have the registers here. And they are connected to all of them. And I've given a command to ALU using the instruction, say, sum R0 and R1 and write it to R2. And it makes two operations. It finds the result somewhere and it writes the result to R2, right? And there's a special circuit here. For example, the result is the result. I'm just writing the result in a big figure. It's 32 bits, right, guys? I have an OR gate relating everything. So they are all connected to an OR gate. OR gate was like this, right? If they are all zero, this becomes one, right? If the results, it is connected to the Z bit here, guys, in the special function registers. That's how it happens. There's an architecture for it. Why there's an architecture for it? You'll understand this when we learn how to make logic using these circuits, guys. But that's how it happens. Şiir açamadım herhalde. Allah Allah, herhalde diyor. Sorry. Benim biraz bilgisayar sapıtıyordu valla. Hah, gelmiş. Şiir geldi mi arkadaşlar? Gelmiş. Tamam. Okay. So that's it. I'm introducing you these registers. So actually, I'm going to give you an example. So guys, I was talking about these instructions. Guys, since I cannot see anybody, I sometimes feel like I lose you. Oradasınız değil mi arkadaşlar hala?
Evet, evet.
Okay, thank you very much. So guys, I've just given an example here, and Alu connected to, but I told you, I gave a command. I told Alu, hey, sum these two and write it to here. And since the architecture is connected such, it happened. How come? These commands I provide are called instructions. And these set of instructions are called the assembly code. We will start microprocessors by learning something called the assembly code. Today, I'm going to make a small introduction to the assembly code. And next week on Wednesday, we are going to discuss this assembly code issue in detail. An assembly language is a very low-level programming language, guys. What does low-level mean? In our context, low-level means it is very close to the hardware. We are just immediately telling hardware what to do. Because these are hardware cells. Find that hardware cell and write something there. This is a very immediate action. For example, let's consider MATLAB code. Let me write a MATLAB code. A equals 3. Well, you know that in a MATLAB code like this, there's a variable A, and the value of that variable A is 3, right? But you don't know where A is, in what bit part of the what part of the memory, how is it kept? Is this an integer? Because it's a very high-level language. We don't bother to think those. But in a low-level language, we are touching the hardware. We are telling the hardware to do exactly what? I mean, just define it number 3, but put it in this hardware position and assume that it's a two's complement number, kind of. We are telling everything. That's why it's called a low-level programming language. An assembly is the lowest level language you can ever find. So it is the first time we are touching the hardware to program it. So guys, this is a simple picturization of the architecture, right? And when I gave examples, I always gave the examples according to the architecture. Since I talked about a comment about this architecture, every assembly language is specific to the architecture. But this is very important. I mean, when you code a MATLAB code, you don't care what type of microprocessor the computer has. I mean, does it have an Intel microprocessor? Where is it running? So what kind of arithmetic logic unit does it have? What is the memory? Do you care? You don't, because that's a high-level programming language. But if you're doing an assembly language, you are touching the hardware. You are telling exactly the hardware where to put the information and blah, blah, and etc. And in that case, your assembly language must be particular for that architecture. So when you learn an assembly language, actually you are learning the architecture. And in contrast, most high-level programming languages, just like the example I've given in MATLAB, they are generally portable across multiple architectures. That's why they are called high-level. But there must be something in between. I mean, you are writing MATLAB, and MATLAB automatically understands it and touches the hardware. So MATLAB does this for you. MATLAB just installs itself to your computer. This is an ARM microprocessor. Okay, let me just figure myself such that I'll be able to use just provide the user with the necessary interface. But this is not the case. When you're doing assembly language, there is nothing in between you and the hardware. That's why assembly language is also called the symbolic machine code. The machine code you are touching, but you're using symbols. What kind of symbols? Let's get to it. Do you remember this previous week's slide? I've used these symbols, guys. I said subtract one register from the other and write it to this register. And since it was all, I mean, architectural design was all proper for this, when I just write sub, which is 0001 to this bit, and 7 to these instructions, it automatically happened because the connections of the lines were proper. So actually this line was a machine code instruction. And this is a machine code instruction. And this is the symbol I used to represent it. Okay? This is human understandable. But actually the binary equivalent or the hexadecimal equivalent is this. And this is subtraction. So this is how I understand as a human. So this is the binary equivalent. This is called a machine code. And this is called the symbolic or the mnemonic. Mnemonic is something. So mnemonic, let me write it just. I'll stop the share again. It's also called, guys, mnemonic. You'll see this. Mnemonic is a strange word. N and together, and you don't read N. It's a mnemonic. It's okay. Okay, let me share screen. Okay, you got it. So this is the assembly language, guys. Actually, this was a stupid assembly language we created for this example. But for ARM, there is actually an assembly language. And when we use this assembly language, when we use lines like this, the interface we use, which is the Kale that you installed to your computers, your lab manual will explain how to install it, will understand it. It will convert this to these machine codes, and you will just do the assembly. So guys, assembly language. Let me just introduce you the assembly language of the ARM. That's the last thing I'm going to do today. Assembly language syntax is very simple, guys. There are four fields. Okay, some of them optional, some of them compulsory. The first is the label. Actually, this will be like a title. When you don't have to understand this, you get to it. This is the important part. This is the opcode. This is like the sub thing here, so subtract. The exact operation, this designated the exact operation LOD, remember? So it is the opcode, like move. It's like move a value. And these are the operands, the third part. This actually says that get this decimal value and write it to R0. Okay, move. And if you use this semicolon, you could write a comment as well. Four fields. So let me just show you an example. So these are four fields. Labels, optional. It's like the titles to indicate where you are at the program. The opcode, the operation, operand, these are the two things that we should understand right now. And comments. And next week, I'm going to show you some examples. Before that, I'm going to start show you a very simple code example, guys, which includes all the four fields. This is the first field, like the label. So it is like indicating which part we are. This is the start. I mean, I say that this is the start of my program. Why I call this start? Maybe at some other part of my program, I'm going to say jump to start. That's why I put this label here. So it doesn't mention a comment. It is like a position in my code. Instead of using line numbers, I use these labels. I don't have line numbers. These line numbers are for showing you where you are. So this is not a part of the assembly language. This is a part of the assembly language. And this is the opcode, guys. These are the opcodes. This is actually, I'm going to teach you these opcodes. Load register, LDR, load register. This is R2, the register name. And this is M. I'm going to teach you what M is. M is actually a value, like an integer, like a variable value. What I'm saying is get the value of M and write it to register to here, okay? Sorry, we don't go there yet. For example, another value or some other actions using these boxes. It's very important. I'm going to teach you the following weeks. And these are the comments. So four fields of the assembly code. This label, the opcodes, the operands, and the comments. Comments and labels are optional. You put labels when you need them. You put the comments for you or your friends to understand your code. But these are not optional. You have to have these. So the language we are going to learn in this course will look like this. And there's a, I provide writing ARM assembly part one. So if you want to just read, I'm going to teach you these, but I like providing nice internet examples here. So this is something you can find. So this is basically what assembly code is. I'm going to go over this code next week, line by line, show you what is what, and what does it exactly do. And you'll understand you'll have a better understanding. And I'm going to introduce you some operands and some addressing modes. We are going to talk about this a lot. Okay, so we stop here. Any questions?
Hocam, duyuyor musunuz bana?
Duyuyorum, duyuyorum.
Bizim bitirme projemiz vardı da, bitirme projesi için bize bir Zoom ID veya bir şifre vermediniz. Saat.
Ha, okey, tabii haklısın ya, unuttum ben sizi. Tamam, ben size hemen şimdi e-mail atarım 5 dakika sonra.
Tamam hocam, teşekkürler.
Ya, 12.30'da değil mi?
2. 12.30'da değil.
2.30'da olanlar var, onlar ne yapsın? Bir de öyle düşün. 2'ye kadar ben size gönderiyorum. Tamam, 12.30'da olanlar da herhalde şimdi panik olmuşlardı da, onlara da gönderiyorum.
Teşekkürler.
Tamam, okey, thank you. So, we have half an hour before my other lecture starts. Let's do the office hour, if you like. I mean, you can ask questions about previous week or the example we have covered. Find this example. Any questions? I'm all yours.
Hocam, ben size şey soracaktım. Mesela işte mikroçipi aldık ya. Hı-hı. Bunun birkaç tane daha ekipmanı varmış sanırım. Onlar ne veya hangi şeyler daha iyiydi? Onu biraz anlatabilirim.
Okay. Let me stop the share. And let me stop the recording. Because şey başladık ya. Recording'e de bakıyorum.